I'm standing before one of my canvases, and it's a canvas that is a mixture of acrylic gesture, Japanese paper, and collage. And the title of this is called Reflected Elements One, and it's in a series of pieces. And as in my other shows, the paper elements are Japanese papers or washi. The majority of the papers come either pale or, in this case, gray, and then they're painted. The only exception is this bright orange one, which I can't reproduce, so it's purchased like that. And all of the papers do come from Japan. So in this particular series, I do start with, even though it's acrylic, I start with a technically kind of a water-based watercolor technique, in that I'm using very, very thin pigments with lots of water, and I let them dry, and then there are overlays of other gestures, and I'm starting in this case from quite pale and metallic, coming in a sense towards the front plane of the canvas. And as you come to the front plane of the canvas, what draws you are the actual colors and the shapes that bring you into the frontal plane. So these pieces are meant to be dimensional concretely, so that there are a number of planes, but also they're meant to elicit kinds of questions or feelings about, you know, where are these shapes coming from? What happens when they come together? At what moment, you know, do I decide to actually place that with this? And then what is the result of that? So this kind of investigation, we're going to go diagonally for a moment, is mirrored in this second piece. So this is Reflected Elements 2. And in the same way, there are these overlays of acrylic washes, including coming right to the surface here, and then the interplay of painted, torn, and in some cases, actual dimensional pieces of washi. So what has happened with this series is that, unlike the beginnings of the series, so if we look from here, and if we take a long shot of that first painting that we looked at, dimension happens because of the integration and the initiation of sense of plane, so forward, mid, and so-called back plane. Here, what's happening is that the papers and the textures are actually coming away from the canvas, and I started to pleat. And this actually is a throwback, this particular shape, to pieces I did in the 1980s. I just remembered that, actually. So from here, from this series, I started to look at pieces that incorporated, in this case, there are areas that are etching and aquatint, and the Japanese paper punched strings, actual articles that are coming from the surface. And again, the viewer is meant to look at the different elements, and in this case, there's a kind of interplay among all of the, you know, where is that float? Is it floating? Is it tied down? Is it punched through the paper? And because it's actual seagrass, you know, there's an actual concrete dimensional thing. So again, I'm playing with kind of where do those things relate in space in terms of your, and in a sense, what are the meaning? What's the meaning of that? Part of that has to do with this folded bit. So if you look at this folded bit, I'll take us here to some of these pieces. So this piece here, this is called Bound Secret Number One, and it's meant to either hang the way you see it, or dare I do this. So this mid part actually comes off, and it can be looked at flat. And when you look at it flat, the piece opens. Okay, so the piece actually, there's an actual, and it would lay flat but dimensional on the surface. So I'm not going to try and stick that back right now, but that sleeve is meant to slide off. So what happened was I started to play with all this idea of folding, and in some cases Oh, that's kind of, sorry, it's been weighted down. So the papers have been folded and put together in a somewhat random fashion. And I'm just going to pull out one of these pieces here. No, I'm not. It's securely put in. So right here, there is a photograph of a part of a painting from maybe 15 years ago. So one of the things that's starting to happen is I'm starting to look back and include papers and images that have been kind of sitting in drawers. So that's where the idea of found came about, that I'm always kind of looking. So there's this kind of looking for what goes with what, not necessarily knowing what the so-called meaning is. The meaning for me is something that really comes about, sometimes it's later, sometimes it's during the piece, but often I will do things more like instinct. I think, okay, I need to fold this paper in this way. Why? I don't know. So I try not to intellectualize it while I'm doing it. I do it first, and then I look at it and I go, what does that mean? So in these ones, and this one too, so I'm just going to tip this towards you so you can look in. This is actually, so this piece is meant to either hang, it's also meant to stand upright. And what makes it stand upright is there's a weight inside. I don't know if you can see it. There's a little weight inside. It's a brush. And then there's this metal part. So this allows this piece to be suspended in air like this, or put on something, and then that string would keep it in place, a little bit like the other bound secret. So I'm interested in visually working with papers and with gestures with this idea that there is a kind of obvious meaning, and the meaning for the artist or the maker, and then the viewer comes and looks at it, and of course they bring their whatever their experience is to that, and the title should help them. But I like this idea that there are all these layers of meanings, and a lot of them are hidden. And in pieces like this, there are pieces in those papers that are very beautiful. You don't see them. And in some cases, so like in this piece here, if you decide that you want to have the piece flat, then you can open, but you can only open it so far because I've put a kind of a barrier. So it cannot be taken apart completely. So there's always a part that's a little bit hidden. Okay, and then from there came these other pieces where, unlike the banners that I've shown in the past, the banners that I've shown in the past have been fully frontal. Sometimes they're suspended from the ceiling, but they're fairly accessible to the viewer. These pieces, again, there's this kind of hidden quality. And I started to work with very, very long pieces of painted washi, and I had them on the floor. And there's, you know, paper has a kind of a natural place where it wants to fold, and then there's a part where it doesn't want to fold. So I was working with taking the edge of it and rolling it and saying, okay, how much of a kind of a linear quality can I get with that first fold? And then I would make the fold. So in the beginning when I did these, I didn't have a full idea of what it was going to look like, which is, I guess, true of all of my work, actually. So I did the first fold, and then I did the second fold, and I looked at it, and I went, oh, and then I sit there and I look at them. And then I started to fold. So let me just, I will show you the inside. I think I'm going to show you the inside. So some of these, how they stay together is that there's a metal piece on one side, and then there is a magnet on the other piece. So sometimes there is something on the inside. So we could, and then it disappears. So I like this fact that it's a flat piece, but there's a sense of kind of it's opening like a garment. And the title of all of these is Ori Body Wraps. So Ori in Japanese is fold. So origami. So that's most people's understanding. They go, oh, do you do paper cranes? I have never made a crane in my life. I'm not proud of it, but that's just the way it is. But for me, these very much are about folding, but also, and what happens when you fold this side over this side? So like Western clothing, Japanese kimonos, if you're a man, you tend to fold this way. If you're a woman, you fold that way. So there's things about gender and someone asked me, they said, well, you're calling them body reps. So I imagine them as literally as like that, that they're meant to envelop a body, but of course we're talking about a very long, very tall, maybe a Giacometti body, who knows. So here's another one on this side. And actually, then I would like to talk about the ones in the window. So same thing here. Sometimes what I will do is I put another paper on the inside, and that's really more for structure. It's to give it some kind of weight so it's not too floppy. But the thing is that if it is hanging on the wall or if it's hanging across a bamboo, sometimes you'll get that little glimpse of what's on the other side. And in a lot of Japanese clothing, particularly for older people, so if, like many things Japanese, there's all these rules, whether you adhere to them is something else. But so as young women will wear pinks and light pastel colors, and as a woman ages, she's expected to be a little more sober. So some of the kimonos in Japan, they're quite dark on the outside, but you open the inside and all of a sudden there's all this color and this magnificent stuff, but you don't see it. So I like that idea that there are these things on the inside that are there, and even though on the outside they're relatively sober, there's this other kind of secret quality. So let's look at this one. So then what happened is I started to fold these pieces. And when you do that, what happens is you're able to look at the both sides. So you're in this case, you know, during the day, the light comes in and it reflects a certain way, and then at nighttime it looks a little bit differently. So if they're suspended on bamboo like that, you basically get the two sides, and then same thing. So in this case, there is an inside that you get a little, and it's a different paper with a different kind of figuration on the inside. And this one was one of my favorites. I'm going to actually pick it up. And it was a little too big for the gallery. And what happened is I put it in the window, and it's just, I think it's just a little too dark. So I'm just going to show us maybe here in the light. So again, the thing that I like about the Japanese paper is you can have really a kind of dense and intense color, but because of the way the paper behaves, particularly if you work, because I work with a lot of metallics, you get these layers, you know. So it is sober and dark, you know, but again, with the right light, and so you can see when they're lit a certain way, they start to look quite differently, and that's this side of it. So this piece could be like the one in the window. Okay. This piece could be shown like that. Yeah. And so in this case, because the way the paper has been folded, when I actually run a bamboo on it, it's a little askew, which I like. It doesn't always have to be symmetrical like that, you know. So that's kind of fun. Just put that back. So what else can I talk about here? I'd like to actually talk about these pieces. So these pieces are a part of a series that are actually quite old, and I'm going to lift them up so we can get some light on them. And this harkens back to my printmaking days. So these are Japanese papers which have been put through the press, and there's a Western paper behind it. Western meaning like Arsch or BFK or something like that. So these have been put through the press. They are monotypes. Sometimes I'll use things like wire. And then in this case, I've been using a lot of plant-based material, which actually goes through the press. So not only does it bleed and leave a kind of a stain, but it embosses and actually gives this sense of plant. So this particular piece started in 1984, and then it was finished in 2019. So these parts here have been added in. So again, the found equation is that sometimes pieces will actually stay in my studio because they don't feel as if they're done, but I don't know what to do with them. So they sit there, and then I drag them out every few years. I look at them, I go, no, not quite. And they go back in the drawer. So these pieces, they're 2019, but again, some of the papers themselves have been, like this series here, which you will see in quite a few pieces. That particular series is about a year old. And again, they arrive like spontaneous gesture on Japanese paper, and they were complete, but they didn't feel complete. And again, I didn't know what to do. So in that case, I stop, I put them away, and I start something else. And until they, in a sense, can kind of find where they belong. So same thing with this one here. And this one's dimensional as well. Same thing with this one here. So for instance, this silk is silk that came from Japan that was a gift from my grandmother's best friend. So this came to me in the 1950s. And so there are little snippets of it here and there. So in a way, these pieces are very much about now, but they've been intermingled with things from the past that have kind of crept in. And I'm curious about them. I'm not entirely sure where it's pointing. But for me, there's something, particularly when I do things like collage. I know many artists work in collage, and many teachers teach collage, but I really, and for myself, I insist on my own material. I'm not interested in, like for instance, at the point that I'm going to use photography, it has to be my own photographs. That's just me. So I, in fact, that's probably the next step, and I'm going to show you a little teaser here. If we can. So here, it's on Japanese paper. It's from a photograph taken in Japan, and the title is Every Mother's Heart. So again, if I'm going to use photographic material for me, it has to be my own. It has to reference my own experience, in a sense. What else? I can show you these small pieces. Yeah, so in these smaller pieces, there's some unknown Japanese writing. So sometimes I will find something that is a text that has an unknown source. So there are times I will let things creep in, you know. But it would not be the bulk of the piece. So in all these ones, you can see that I'm beginning to, there's something about this string quality. So this is a kind of silk thread that itself has a lot of different colors on the spool. It comes from Italy, beautiful thread. And I like the idea of the fact that the papers are folded, there's a bit of an etched quality. Sometimes I've punched right through, and then the string ties things together, and then there's always this kind of loose end. So it's never nailed down. I want the viewer to be able to bring their own sense of what the meaning of the piece may be for themselves. So there's something else. Yeah. And what else? This one here. This one is an unusual piece for me, wherein I used an actual textile as a background, and then starting to actually put things or implements. And I'm curious about it. I'm not, you know, it's, again, it's still kind of experimental. In a way, I see maybe combining the idea of these bound pieces, so really heavily folded pieces with actually information that are then brought into the piece. So again, the meaning is there, but you can't read it. Okay, and maybe there'll be, in the title, there'll be a little bit of a clue. So I like this idea that it's open, secret, but still secret. So this idea of bound or secret, you know, is very much a part of this work.